I'm just thanking.
Oh,
right, all right, all right. I remember when sin was sin. And I remember when wrong was wrong. And I remember when we all fell short and got back up much quicker than the fall. Well, I'm praying that you open our eyes.
Was wrong, and you can make it with some holy conviction, a little love and correction. You can take these burdens and give us one last night. So here I am, Jesus. You can make it right. Yeah.
You can take what's wrong.
You can make it right.
You can make it right.
His presence.
When I come into His presence.
up both my hands.
Lift up both my hands, and I begin to worship Him.
Come on and magnify the Lord with us. Let's exalt His name together.
Restores my soul
and my
mercy and goodness.
Give me assurance.
Give me
assurance.
I'll see His glory.
Face to face.
Mercy and goodness.
Mercy and goodness.
Give me assurance.
Give me assurance.
I'll see His glory.
His glory.
Face to face.
Oh,
Good morning. Our scripture reading will be coming from Ephesians 6, starting at the 10th verse. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For do not wrestle with flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand forth and have you girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shrouded your feet with the preparation of gospel of peace. Excuse me. Above all, take up the shield of faith, which is with you to be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with prayer and supplications in the Spirit, being watchful to the end, and with all preservation and supplications for all the saints. I've just read Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 18. May the Lord have a blessing on the readers, hearers, doers of his most holy word.
They're not a friend like the lonely Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high.
Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today we're going to celebrate the Holy One. He is the Prince of Peace. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the great I Am. Come on, let's give God some praise.
Oh, Giving honor to God, to Pastor Mack, associate ministers, officers, members, and friends, good morning. Next Sunday, March 31st at 9:30 a.m., the Sunday School Department will present our Easter pageant. The kids have been working very hard. I don't know if some of y'all were coming in early. You saw them in here this morning practicing. So we're asking that you be here at the 9:30 a.m. hour to help support them. That being said, we have one rehearsal left next Saturday, March 30th, from 10 a.m. to noon. This will be a full dress rehearsal, so we are asking that everyone that is on program please be in attendance. After the rehearsal at noon, we will have our annual Easter egg hunt with food being provided by our UBC Culinary Committee. We have lots of eggs, lots of candy, and prizes, but we still are taking donations. So, if you would like to donate eggs, candy, or prizes, you can see myself, Sister Florine Brooks, who's sitting in the back, Sister Lisa Richmond, who's sitting over there, or you can drop them off at the church office and they will see to it that it gets to where it needs to go. To all those that have already donated, we thank you. We appreciate you for continuing to support Sunday school, continuing to support our youth, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Just thank you for this opportunity, Lord, that we can come and just to sing and hear the word of God. But Lord, we just thank you for giving.
Yes.
We're not selfish, but we just give to you. You only ask for 10. So Lord, we just doing a little bit of it. Not all we should do. But Lord, we thank you. Now, Lord, we just thank you for this offering. Lord, bless those that give. Bless those that have a desire to give but do not have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and come around.
Thank you.
Who let the dogs out? Praise God. Somebody, that fellow on the drums, I didn't know we even had a drummer. Amen. Praise God. God bless you, I tell you. God bless you, fellas. Y'all all right with me, all right with me. Listen, I don't have any registered visitors, but I certainly want to recognize if there be any visitors among us. Would you please stand? We are so happy to have you in our midst. Amen. We are, God bless you, and we are all family on this morning. I'm moving right along. I want to have two recognitions. I'm looking over the congregation. Oh, there my girl is. Amen. I want to recognize Ozzy. Amen. Stand up, Ozzy. Amen. God bless you. This certificate of completion, certifies that Azalea Hill has successfully completed Kiel's, that's micro shadowing class. Amen. Give Azalea a hand clap of praise if you can. I know folk who ain't doing nothing, but they always tired, they always talking about what I don't have time to do, can't do, but when you are doing all of that and in between all of that, that class was not here, that class was in Atlanta. And so when you have time to make it, fit it in, amen. I just think we ought to honor and recognize folk to them. Amen. To keep up the good work. God bless you. God bless you. And then Isaac here this morning? Isaac is not here. Let me say this then. I saw Elise, amen, Anise, she's here. That's Isaac's sister. I want to, let me see. This is on behalf of the Kiwanis Club of Springfield downtown. We're featuring superhero kids of our superhero hustle, K5K on April 13th, and Isaac will be recognized. Today's superhero kid is Isaac. Amen. Our own Isaac. He was nominated by the outlet who says, here's what the outlet said, says that Isaac embodies the qualities of a true superhero. Bravery in the face of adversity, kindness towards others, and a commitment to making the world a better place. Despite facing personal challenges, he continues to shine brightly and make a positive impact on those around him. His resilience, generosity, and passion for helping others make him a deserving candidate for the Superhero Award. This is for Isaac. God bless you. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Let's go to the Word of God. Let's go to the Word of God. Listen, I know there is a printed text, and you probably have positioned your Bibles to the printed text, but this being Palm Sunday, I want to allow me, if you would, to deviate from. We are in the midst of preaching the seven last sayings of Jesus, and today would have been the third saying, but if you would allow me to deal with Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. I've reached a point, y'all, where I don't pull rabbits out of my hat anymore. I'm about education, and when I look at the congregation in which I pastor, and you read your Bibles, and you take notes, and some of the email that you send me, and the comments that you make, it just causes me to go on further and dig a little deeper. And so I don't want to preach something that has nothing to do with the occasion. And so I want to deal with Palm Sunday today, and Easter Sunday next Sunday. That just makes sense, doesn't it? And then we'll pick up the seven last statements, commencing with number three, the third statement, after Easter, if you would allow me to do that, I appreciate it. So I'm going to make it easy on you. We're going to still deal with the Gospels. Let's go to Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21, and I'm reading, brothers and sisters, from the New Living Translation, chapter 21, and I want to read those about 11 verses there to give us the what's going on. Bear with me. Chapter 21, and I'm commencing at verse 1. Listen to what it says. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. Go into the village over there, he said. As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its coat beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks, what are you doing? Just say to them, the Lord needs them, and he will immediately let them go. This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, tell the people of Jerusalem, look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey's coat. The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the coat to him and threw their garments over the coat, and they sat on it, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, praise God for the Son of David, blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heaven. The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. Who is this? They asked. The crowd replied, it's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. God bless you. You may be seated. I'm going to tag this one this morning, a lesson from a donkey. I thought it was more fitting to read the New Living Translation because King James Translation says that refers to the donkey as an ass. And it just sounds so much better, a lesson from a donkey rather than a lesson from an ass. Though we would relate to it, it just sounds better for good church folk to. Y'all gonna help me in here? When I deal with and when I look at this morning's text, brothers and sisters, there is so much in here as we reflect and we look at this particular passage of scripture and this whole concept of Palm Sunday. There is no limit on what God can use or what God or who God will use when it comes to God getting his message across to us. And this is a powerful message because on this morning, we see that in order for God to get glory and to get honor, which is worthy of, he is worthy of all honor. He's due that. In fact, when it comes to me giving God praise, giving God honor and giving him glory, I'm in debt and I cannot pay. So I'm constantly trying to lift my hands. I'm constantly trying to open my mouth. I'm constantly trying to do something to pay him back. How much do you owe God? How much glory can you give God for waking you up every day? And you know, if the truth was told, we don't deserve it. Many of you are like me. And if we put our goodness on a scale and we were to be awakened based on our goodness, most of us would be sleeping in our graves right now. And so when you look at God, everything he created, he wants it to give him glory and honor. And this is a passage that is unusual because it allows us to notice that God will go to no limit to get something or somebody to give him the honor that is due to him. We don't have to stop there. He uses the elements, if I might say so. Water, wind, fire, earth. He used water. You remember he told Noah, I need you to build an ark because I'm getting ready. Before Noah built the ark, brothers and sisters, it never rained. Water would come and would moisturize the ground, and the dew from the moisture would cause vegetation to grow. But God says, I'm getting ready to send some water that you ain't never seen before. And he, you know the story, he caused it to rain for 40 days and 40 nights just so he could get glory. Oh, you missed that. You missed that. It wasn't just water, but God allowed the wind to blow. And come here, Noah. Noah, rather, Moses will tell you that he led the children of Israel out of Egypt land. And they got to the Red Sea. They had Pharaoh behind them, and they had mountains on each side of them. And in front of them, they had the Red Sea, and God, when they had nowhere to turn, and I'm talking to somebody in here, you've reached a Red Sea in your life. You have nowhere to turn, but God says he will send the elements. He sent the wind, the Bible said, an east wind, and the wind blew. Not only did it divide the water, but it also, another wind came through and dried the Red Sea. I've been out to cemetery after cemetery, and I hate when I get up and I've got to go to the cemetery and it's been raining. Because I'm going to come out with mud, looking like I've been in the country. Talk to me in here. But God did not do them like that. He sent an east wind and it dried up the dry ground, and they walked across on dry ground. He sent water. He used wind. He used fire. The prophet Elijah. And y'all causing me to slow down this morning. When you caused me to slow down the sermon that was designed to be 30 minutes, it turned into 45 minutes or an hour. He had Elijah down at Mount Carmel. And you remember the prophets had built their altar. And Elijah built his altar. And they called on the Lord. And Elijah called on his God. And God rained down fire. Somebody ought to say earth, wind, and fire. He rained down fire. And the fire sapped up all of the altar, all of the water. And he will even use the earth. Because we haven't gotten to it yet. But when Jesus died on the cross at Calvary, the Bible said that the earth quaked, the earth shook. And when the earth shook, the dead got up and walked the streets of Jerusalem. God will go to any degree to get glory and honor. And I don't know how you feel about it, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, but this text closes. I didn't read it for you, but it closes by saying, if these hold their peace, then the rocks will cry out. And I don't know about you, but I don't want no rocks crying out to me. And so here, when you look at this text, brothers and sisters, God now uses a donkey to teach us a lesson. Down through the pages of history, through the scripture, a donkey has been used over and over and time again. There is a straying donkey. 1 Samuel 9:3, Kish had a donkey and he went to King Saul, and King Saul warned him or talked to him about that straying donkey. And don't you frown on that ass, because sometimes we are a straying donkey. Sometimes we have an eoch mentality. We stray away. I'm not going to mess with you this morning. I have strayed. I have gotten off the mark, but thanks be to God that there was somebody that came back and had patience with me. And if God had patience with us, then why can't we have patience with each other? Straying donkey. But then there was also a sentenced donkey. Because in Exodus 13:13, that it says that the firstborn the donkey had to be bought back, and it had to be bought back by a goat or a lamb. If you couldn't, a sentenced donkey, if you could not buy it back, the family could not buy it back, then the donkey's neck had to be broken. A sentenced donkey. And oh, I'm so glad that on the cross at Calvary, when my neck should have been broken, God sent his son Jesus to move me out of you two out of the way, so we would not be sentenced. But then there's a speaking donkey in Numbers 22. Verses 28 through 30, there was a speaking donkey. Balaam was going to throw out a curse on Egypt. And when he was going to throw out the curse on Egypt, he was riding a donkey, and that donkey saw God. The Bible said the donkey stopped in the middle of the road, and Balaam literally beat that donkey. And when he beat the donkey, not once, not twice, but three times. And on the third time, the donkey turned around and talked to him. A speaking donkey. God put voice in the donkey's mouth. And the donkey said, I ain't going another further. And Balaam began to talk back to the donkey. And the donkey says, why are you beating me? And the donkey goes on and says, you don't see what I see. And Balaam could not see that God was in front of the donkey, holding him up. And sometimes, y'all, things happen in our lives, and the person beside you, the person behind you, does not see it. But you better mind what God says. And is it better to please God than to please man? Because folk don't see what you see. And sometimes when folk don't see what you see, you got to stand all by yourself like a donkey in the middle of the road. Turn and look them in the face, your brother, your sister, your mother, somebody, and tell them, I ain't going another further. A speaking donkey, a straying donkey, a sentenced donkey. But here God this morning uses a serving donkey. Which suggests to us we played the role of the straying and the sentence and the speaking. But brothers and sisters, now God shines the spotlight on this morning's message by letting us know and encouraging us that you should be a servant for the Lord. Over and over, you'll hear me say it this morning, because in this text, what we discovered is that with this donkey and with you and I, God says to each one of us, the Lord has need of you. which means that he wants to use us. God, why do you want to use me? Because God has a plan, brothers and sisters. And with this donkey, this whole donkey situation was prophesied by Zechariah 9:9. And in that, Zechariah prophesies, "Rejoice greatly, O daughters of Zion, shout, daughters of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you and is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey." Prophesied by the prophet Zechariah. But now, brothers and sisters, the prophecy comes true. And God uses a donkey to fulfill his divine plan. God always has a plan. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but you're ready to throw in the towel. You keep trying to get in the mix. You keep messing up stuff. But let God work his plan. You ever been kind of somewhere and you were out of pocket? Maybe it was Christmas or Thanksgiving and food was being prepared in the kitchen and grandma who uses a pinch of this and a little bit of that and a little, she doesn't use a measuring cup or a spoon or anything. She just knows what. Have anybody ever given you, and I ain't talking about no stuffing, I'm talking about dressing. Anybody ever given you a recipe? Have you ever seen a written down recipe of? Oh, talk to me in here. You ain't never seen a written down recipe of 2 cups of this and 2 cups of that and how much cornbread goes in, how much breadcrumbs go in, how much? And for people who don't know, they stand around in the kitchen. And while mama is working, they're in the way. They're trying to do. Can I talk to you this morning? In my life, there have been times that I was in my own way. God had a plan and he was trying to work the plan, and because I didn't know that he was going to use a pinch of this and a handful of that and a dash of this to work my plan, I was just in the way. But God wants me to tell somebody this morning, you just stand there, be tied up, and when he's ready to use you, he will loose you. He'll loose you for the work that he has prepared for you. God has a plan. Here it is. Number one, God's plan must be executed. Watch the text here. Watch the text. God tells them. He tells us, rather, by way of these disciples, he tells us where to go. He tells us what to do, when to do it, and what to do when we get there. Watch this text, because he does this. He tells the disciples when to go when you get to Jerusalem. He tells them where to go to this town, this village of Bethage. He tells them where to off the coast from the Mount of Olives, down from the Mount Olives. What am I to do when I get there? He tells them with this plan, there will be a colt and a donkey. Untie them. You can't beat that. Now you can add something to it. The disciples could have done that, but all they had to do was follow his instructions, his plan, divine plan, if I might say. And I come to tell you, I now understand what Jeremiah 29 means when he said, "I know the plans I have for you." God has already walked this path. Wherever you are in your life right now, he's already been there. He's already, God has a t-shirt, a cap, a mug, all of whatever it is you're going through. He has all of that to show. And so he says to you and I, follow my plan. And that's what the disciples did. Here it is, y'all. His plan is pre-arranged. It's kind of like, and folk who look like you and I, we don't talk about it. And I'm getting ready, as we did last week, we had Dr. Hope to come in and talk about trauma in our lives and so many things he said. Though I'm not an educator in the school district, it was so much that he said that pierced and worked and helped me to understand my issues and helped me to understand other folks' issue and what I've been holding back, what I've been holding in inside. And what I discovered here, brothers and sisters, is that with God, He knows the plans that He has for us, meaning that everything is prearranged. And like we did with Dr. Hope, we want to bring folk in because people of color don't make prearrangements for death. Oh, we go to church and we talk about it, by and by I want to go to heaven. But the times in which God has protected me, built a fence all around me, you don't know who is out there drunk driving you. They got a thing they call a functioning alcoholic. That's one who can drink far more than you and I. This is not about do you drink, but it... He or she can drink far more than you and I, and they function. No lie. This is my daddy. He was a barber all his life. And his reputation was that if you wanted a good haircut, catch him when he got a drink. Because when he gets full of the sauce, that's when he does his best. This was before we knew what a functioning alcoholic was. What they were literally saying was he functions at his best. Y'all don't hear me in here. When he's got a little motivation in him. And brothers and sisters, all I'm saying is that there are folk out there who are functioning and they are loaded. Whether it's drugs or whether it's alcohol or whatever, however, if you're separated, but God protects us. And I love that song, and I'm moving on. I love that song because I don't want to keep you. I love that song. Somebody prayed for me, had me on their mind. Mother Stevenson, they took the time and they prayed for me. That was when I love that song so much because that was when I didn't have sense enough to pray for myself. But thank God that somebody was praying for me. So God protects us. He provides for us. He does things for us. But when it comes to us, we don't make Him an immediate priority. Where are you going, Pastor? He tells them that this thing that I'm having y'all to do is urgent. Go down there. When you get there, you're going to find a colt and a donkey. Untie them. If anybody asks you, this is how urgent it is. If anybody asks you, what are you doing? You just tell them this. The Lord has need of it. Now my car out there on the parking lot, and you out there trying to get in my car because you want to take my car, and somebody walks up, good security, one of the deacons, one of the men working security out there, they walk up on you and they say, hey, what you doing? And you say, I have need. The Lord has need of it. I'm taking, this is synonymous to what Jesus is telling them to do. This is so urgent until Jesus is telling them to take no thought on what you're going to do. And I have to deal with this, brothers and sisters, because with you and I, everything becomes first and God becomes secondary. I'm guilty. I've been there before, whether it's getting in the Word and do some studying, whether it's going to church, whether it's doing something for the Lord, whether it's paying, giving your tithe. Something always, amen. Oh, brother, pastor, I would give, but I got all of these bills. Well, who made the bills? Amen. Every bill I got my name on it. And we complain about it because the bills that we make, if we had taken the top
There it is, the priority being God, then those bills wouldn't even be an issue. Oh, I don't make as much money as you. It's not about how much you make, because God does not say, I want you to pay this and you pay that and you can't afford it. No, he says a tenth. So if I don't make but $10, all God says, give me a dollar. Well, over here, this fella makes $10,000, makes $1,000. God says, but you, I just want a dollar because you don't make. You can't beat that. You're looking at me like math wasn't your best subject, brothers and sisters, but that's simple. And if we put God, why are you talking about that, Pastor? Because I've been there. And when you put God first, oh, I wish you would know how doors would open, how things would fall in place, because I put God first. You know what vexed me? When I'm talking to somebody, you have a 10 o'clock appointment with the pastor. Now, my orthodontist, if I'm not there at 10 o'clock, I have a 15-minute window. And after 15 minutes, not only do I lose the appointment, but I also get charged extra. But when it comes to the pastor, he ain't doing nothing, no way. He can wait for me. 10 o'clock, but I'll get there 10:30 or whenever. Then when you get there, somebody is texting you more important than what we're talking about. I know I'm not by myself. You've seen people that's got, okay, you're not saying anything on that. You're going through the line at Myers, Walmart, Target. You're going through the line, and the post person at the checkout, instead of them talking to the clerk, they talking on the phone while they're checking. What is it so important on that phone? What's holding priorities that you can't hang up, put it down? Let me check out. I'll call you when I get in the car. Talk to me in here, y'all. Amen. What is it so important that every notification that comes in, you got to respond right then? But when it comes to God, well, I'll get around to it when I get around to it. Even in our prayers, and I didn't mean to stay on this that long, but even in our prayers, well, I tried this and I tried this. I guess I'll pray now. When prayer should have been your first, well, this ain't gonna work. This ain't gonna work. That didn't work. Mom and them ain't got no money. Uncle Joe ain't got no money. Well, I guess he has us as his priority. But we make him secondary. And he tells his disciples here that this is urgent. What's about to take place? In other words, it's not written in the text. These are words that we have created. In other words, he says, this is the beginning of Holy Week. He says, today I'm going to ride in to Jerusalem. But the next time I go into Jerusalem, I'll be walking in. Today I'm going to be on a donkey. But 7 days later, the next time I go into Jerusalem, a cross going to be on my shoulder. This is urgent. He says, fellas, follow my instructions and follow them to the lesson. And I love this, brothers and sisters, because it reminds us, number one, that God's plan must be executed. But then secondly, God's plan will always have potential distractions. Whenever you dare to put God first, something will always distract you. You want to lift your holy hands, but you're concerned about what somebody's thinking about you. And here's what I love about you, UBC, is that we don't come in and have a Simon Says worship. Ask me, Pastor, what's a Simon Says worship? when Simon says, stand up on your feet, turn to your neighbor. When Simon says, come on, get up. If the Lord is down, you ought to do this. No, we worship spontaneously. That when I feel the Holy Spirit, then I lift my hands. When I feel the Holy Spirit, then I stand up. When I feel, and if I don't stand up, if I don't lift my hands, it's okay for me just to sit there and rock. It's okay for me just to pat my feet, and nobody in here beats you up because you ain't hollering. After church, y'all tell me how to spell hollering. Because you're not in the middle of the aisle, you're not in the floor. And when you look at this text, brothers and sisters, there's going to always be a distraction. Don't you get caught up into all of that stuff. However you worship our God is fine with our God. If I want to whoop and holler and sweat, I'm good as long as the nurses keep bringing me a towel to wipe my wet face. But if you never sweat, your worship with God is just as good. Don't let nobody distract you saying, this is the way you do it. You holler back at them, no, this is the way I do it. Ain't nobody going to help me in here. Always going to be some distractions. Listen. The donkey's destiny is tied to the disciples' obedience. Had the disciples, we've got to mature to the level, the spiritual maturity to the level of the disciples' obedience, and that is to follow God's instructions, the plan that he has for us. Christ gave them instructions, and that donkey's destiny was to allow Christ to ride on his back, untamed. Watch that now, untamed. Had the disciples decided to do it their way? Look here. He wants us to go down there and take somebody's donkey. Man, we might get stabbed. The owner might run up on us. So here's what we're going to do. I know a corral of donkeys. We're going to go over here and get one of these donkeys. Ain't nobody gonna ever miss it. He been walking all this time. He can ride on this donkey. But instead, they followed Jesus to the lesson. And what a message for all of us, brothers and sisters. Don't add nothing. Don't take nothing away. If God said do it, you just, no matter how weird, how crazy, there are some folk I'm looking at right now who have retired, and you couldn't see leaving East St. Louis. You couldn't see leaving Tennessee, leaving down south, coming to a place where you had never been before. But because God said, do it, you trusted the Lord, and now aren't you glad you followed? At the same time, we got record. We have record where we did not trust the Lord. We took matters in our own hands and we messed up. I ain't gonna make you call no names, but aren't you? Do you ever think about the person that you did not marry? I'm gonna wait on you in here. You thought you love you some him and some her. Now you look back. That thing has gone full circle and you look back. I don't know what that song says. Looking back over my life, I must have shedded some tears. Told myself time and time again, this time seems another fight. Things ain't right. I'm losing again. I think I better. I wish y'all could see TC out there. Yeah. And it's moments like this that we thank God that we followed his
instructions. And here it is, my brothers and sisters, there will always be potential distractions, but here is your response to the distractions. What is it, brother pastor? The Lord has need of me. And so when distractions come, no, I cannot. Nehemiah can put it best in the Old Testament. When Nehemiah said, I'm not coming down, he was building the wall, and they said, come meet with us in one of the villages. And Nehemiah said, no, why should I come down and the work cease, and I come and meet with you? And all I'm trying to tell you this morning is keep on following the will and the way of God, because the safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. Follow his instructions. The distractions, the response to the distraction is the Lord has need of me. God's plan must be executed, brothers and sisters. God's plan always will have distractions. But then thirdly, God's plan, you must position. With God's plan, you must position yourself to be used. God uses us when we're in the right place, when we position ourselves to be used. Look at the text here. The donkey was willing to be untied. The word of God says that this donkey, this mule, this rather colt and donkey had never been ridden before. One of the other gospels say it had never been ridden before, which means it had never had anyone to come up to it, to approach it. But when you watch the text, the disciples had no problem going to this donkey. And though he was tied up, the Bible said that all they did was untied him. And when you look at it here, y'all, you can read it when you get home. When they untied him, someone said, what are you going to do? And they followed Jesus' instructions by saying that the Lord has need of it. And when I look at it here and I look at my Savior this morning, it reminds me and it tells me that the Lord, first of all, number one, he personally set the stage, because he told them that you go down and you get a mule, get that donkey. And when you get to him, he's going to be tied up. And that suggests to me, my brothers and sisters, that we must be willing to be untied. And I've got to ask you this morning, that what is it in your life that has you tied up? And no matter how untamed you may be, God told me to tell you this morning that he can use you. And no matter how much drugs you've had, and no matter how much alcohol, God says, I can still use them. But you've got to be willing to be untied. He personally, y'all, set the stage, but then the Lord purposely showcased the scripture, because he shares with them in verse 4 that the reason why you've got to get a donkey, and I don't want one from anywhere else, is because Zechariah prophesied that I've got to come riding on a donkey. Have I got a witness? He personally set the stage. He purposely showcased the scripture. But here, y'all, and my soul gets happy that the Lord's people shouted for the Savior. What does that mean, Reverend? I didn't read it for you, but when you look at it, y'all, the Bible says in the Gospel of John that they laid down not just branches, but they laid down
Deacon Dixon, there was palm branches. Have I got a witness in here? Well, not just did they lay down palm branches, but the Bible says that King Solomon, way back, started them to laying down coats in the street whenever the king was coming through. But that's not enough, y'all, because in the Hebrew tongue, Jehu, that ride was a regal ride, because only a king rode on a donkey. Have I got a witness? It was the king who rode out to battle on a white horse, but when he came among the people, he just rode on the back of a donkey. Why a donkey, Reverend? Because the donkey was symbolic to peace, symbolic to humility. And now, y'all, I know what it means when it says, oh, I want to be like Jesus. I want to be meek and lowly, humble and holy. I gotta leave y'all here, but I see y'all, the coats in the road, I see the palm branches, I see Jesus, I see him on the donkey. But wait a minute, the Bible said they were at the Mount of Olives. Jesus is setting high in the mountains. Now y'all go down and get the donkey. Watch this now. It's Palm Sunday, and Jesus is coming down that mountain. Have I got a witness? 2,700 feet. He's coming down to Jerusalem. And I got news for you. When the crowd saw him coming, they started raising their voice. And God says that if you're gonna get my attention, you gotta raise your voice. And I got a witness. I heard the psalmist say, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And you should have been there when those folk started crying out. The Bible said that the ones that cried out, they said, Hosanna. Have I got a witness? I can't hear nobody in here. You know, this morning, and I thank God for my young folk. They reminded me, said, Reverend, when you preach, we be shouting back at you. I told them, well, I can't hear you. And all I'm trying to tell you this morning, you can't be quiet. You can't be hush mouth. You can't be bashful. Because if you want the Lord's attention, you got to cry out. When I was a boy, y'all, and I'd fall down and hurt myself, I didn't say, Mama, but I cried out, Mama, come see about me. And is there anybody in here that when things get rough, when things get tough, every now and then I got to cry out to the Lord, and won't he come see about you? I'm out of here, y'all, but I love it. It's not here in this text, but Josephus says that while Jesus on one side of town was coming into town, over on the other side, Pilate was also coming into town, and they weren't crying out to the king. They were shouting out, and that's why the Pharisees said, y'all hush, y'all gonna get us in trouble. But there comes a time in your life that when you've been through something, you ought to cry out, because the Lord does not require you to give a shout if you ain't been through nothing. But if God has brought you out, you ought to cry out. Is it anybody in here who's been in and God brought you out? Now if you ain't never been in and the Lord brought you out, that's all right. Just keep on living. Sooner or later, you're going to find out. He'll be a doctor in a sick room. You're going to find out. He's going to give you some money to pay your bills. You're going to find out. Just keep on living. And when that happens, you can't keep it to yourself. Is it anybody in this house that know for yourself that I've been in and nobody but the Lord brought me out? And when he brought me, I said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I just can't keep it to myself. Hosanna, save us. That's what it means. Psalm 118 said, save us. Savior, save us. And when I get in, I can't call on nobody. Nobody but the Lord. Lord, save me. Is it anybody in here who knows for yourself? Won't he come see about you? Won't he save you? Light. He'll save you. He'll pick you up, turn you around, place your feet on hallelujah ground. I heard them say, y'all better hush, be quiet. But Jesus, my mind working with me, I can hear him say, warn you, if these hold their peace, then the rocks will cry out. And I got news, y'all. I don't want no rocks crying out. So I'm going to shout for Jesus. I'm going to shout for joy. I'm going to tell the Lord, thank you. I'm going to throw my head back. I'm going to lift my hands up. You ain't got to do it if you don't want to. But for me, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. I'm going to shout, thank you. Yes, sir. I'm going to shout, you've been so good to me. I'm going to shout, I don't care who knows it, but thank you, Lord. You brought me. Did he bring you? You ought to say yes. You ought to say yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes, sir. Won't he make a way? Won't he make a way? Won't he make a way? Yes, sir. Ain't he all right? When you ain't got nothing else to say, when you run out of your notes, when you read the scripture, brother pastor, what do you do? I start thinking about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me. And then I start thinking about what I've done and what I should have done. And I think about his grace and mercy. When I get to that point, my cup runs over. What do you do, Reverend? I just stand back, fold my arms, and say, any, all right. I know he's all right. He's all right. Yes, he is. Turn to your neighbor. Give him a high five and say, I know he's all right. A lesson from a donkey. I've spent my time. I know it's not good grammar and it's not good etiquette, but I've been the ass before and I've spent my time, but now I've got it together. And God will go to no limit, even if he has to use a donkey. Whether that donkey is straying, whether that donkey
Satan's, whatever that donkey, stubborn or what, God says to us that we are to serve. So God, Jesus, you can ride me until I'm tamed. Salvation is not so much a one-time thing. Because if I could just, this thing is not like Brillo cream, a little dab of dew. But from the day at 16 years old when I accepted him as my savior, he knew that I needed to be untied. He knew that I needed to be tamed. I watch westerns, McNeil, I watch westerns, and Washington, when I watch them, they get on the wild horses and they ride them until the horse is tamed, and then he'll ride around. Well, I haven't reached that yet. So Jesus, ride me a little bit longer. Stay on me. Whatever you do, don't get off of me. All of my bucking and all of my kicking and all of the noise I make, stay on me, Jesus. Keep on riding me until I can walk right. Until I can talk right. Until I can think right. Until, stay on me, Jesus. I extend this invitation. Those of you who are watching us and even here in this sanctuary, you can text that phone number, you can email that number. We love seeing your face, but you don't have to come down this aisle and look at all of us. There's a team of people standing around the wall. They're here to minister. These men who are in the aisles, they're here to minister to you. Just as you are, already tied and untamed, you can come to Jesus right now. What do I have to do, Pastor? Just make yourself available to him. Tell him, Lord, my storage is empty, and I am available to you. This is what I want to do. I want to give you my hands. I want to give you my heart. I want to give you all of me. Will you come? Will you come? Everything we have, everything we possess, he gave it to us. All he wants is that you give it back to him. After all, he gave his life. Will you come? Will you come? I can hear. What else can you hear? I can hear the cry. But cannot wipe. Is there one? Is there one? Online, the online, those who are watching, you can come. You can come. My will. I give to you, not my will, but your will. I just want you to use me. Will you come? Will you come? Said, my storage. I'm emptying out all of me. All of my. Take this selfishness. Take this unforgiving. You can take your seat. Take your seat. Take all of this away from me so I can be available to you. You've got to give it to me. All the tools. Tell me, what else? What is it? You better be careful. You'll get happy listening to that. You can fill it up. Lord, Lord, here I am, Lord. Thank you, brethren. God bless you.
I'll even do what you say, dude. Lord, use me. There it is, my storage. You can turn your pew into your own private and personal altar. Say my storage. Thank you, Lord. Sister Wilson, can you open those doors so I can pray for those folks standing out in the foyer? God, this morning you woke us up, you started us on our way, you didn't have to do it, but you did, and we dare not take you for granted. So right now, oh God, as we pour ourselves out, we empty our storage, we make ourselves available unto you. And as we're moving and throughout the hustle and bustle of life, our agenda, we got things to do and so much is going on. God, we pray right now, not just me, but all of us, we pray that you will idle us down. Let you be the priority in our lives. Nothing takes the place of you, oh God. Trying to get from point A to point B, God, we want to always put you first. That you'll be that fence of protection all around us. Now, Lord, here we are, and we, each one of us, we have our own supplication. We've got things going on in our families, and even though we've been taught what goes on in the family stays in the family, we did not know, God, that was playing a toll on our organs and causing trauma in our bodies, keeping secrets. God, where you declare that we should release and we should let it go, which is simple forgiveness. And so right now, God, those of us who are, we've turned our pew into an altar, and those who are standing here at the altar, those who are in the office area and in the foyer, oh God, over in the fellowship hall, we pray right now. We know that you hear and you have the power. You hear our prayer wherever we are, but God's synonymous to the incense going up as a sweet smelling aroma. We want my voice and our cries to go out throughout this building as it goes up to you. We pray for our young people. We pray for our families, oh God. We pray
So much is going on. Those who are experiencing grief and bereavement, we pray, we lift them up to you. We never get over this. We just get through it until the next moment. So God, we thank you in spite of everything, the litany of things that we've listed and we've called out to you, we've given to you, oh God, we still say thank you, because our good days outweigh our bad days. We say thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Because we won't complain, we say thank you. Oh God, that you dispatch grace and mercy instead of giving us justice, we say thank you. Lord, that this Palm Sunday you rode into town, and we know what this week is going to bring as we commemorate and we reflect back and we work our way down this Jerusalem trail, the road to Calvary. God, we say thank you for what you've done for us. As it relates to Hosanna, save us. And you did just that. Take us now, O God, from this altar that we'll be better, we feel better. Continue to work on our salvation. Yes, we have accepted you as our Savior. You have given us salvation, but there are still some burrs, some fine-tuning, some things that must be burned of us, have to be taken away from us. Continue to work on us, oh God. And when you get through, we shall come forth as pure gold. We thank you, oh God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Give someone a smile. Give them some love. Encourage them. I am available. Available to you. Lord, I'm so empty. Available. Just tell God, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord. From falling. Now may the grace of God, sweet communion of your Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, abide. abide with us henceforth, now and forevermore. And all of God's people sang together.